to Red Billy Blockchain at Oakland 21 today. I will be more than happy to answer your question after this video presentation. This is joint work with Tyler Crane and Chris Natalie. And my name is Vincent Gramoli, and this work was done at the University of Sydney and CSIRO's Data61. So the goal of this talk is to ensure security. But what do we mean by security? Essentially, we want to make sure that if you have multiple machines that are proposing distinct block to the blockchain, then they will not be appended at the same index of the chain. Because otherwise, it would mean that we could have conflicting transactions accepted in the blockchain as part of a fork. And if this fork remains for long enough, we will have double spending. So we don't want that. Instead, we would like to ensure that all the machines reach a consensus about the uniqueness of the block that should be appended at each index of the blockchain. And we would like to reach consensus despite arbitrary failures or Byzantine failures that can mimic hackers, for example. And we would like to ensure that despite arbitrary delays that can happen in the system, unexpected delays. We want to ensure optimal resilience, which means that we have to tolerate up to a third of Byzantine failures in the system. We would also like to ensure fairness in the sense that even though there is a malicious user sending an infinite number of transactions, then the correct user transaction will eventually be committed by the system. Note that this offers censorship resistance, and this definition is stronger than the liveness guarantee that we usually have in blockchain that simply says that if the transaction is received by the system, then it will be eventually committed. Here we want to ensure that the transaction sent by the client will be committed. Finally, we want to ensure scalability. And by that, we don't mean hundreds of transactions per second as we have hundreds of nodes in the system. We especially don't want to have performance that degrades as we increase the size of the system. We neither want to have a low throughput that is maintained as the size of the system increases. But we would like to achieve higher and higher throughput as we leverage more and more resources in the system. And we would typically expect to reach thousands of transactions per second as we have hundreds of consensus nodes deciding the same block. So this summarizes the three goals that we want to achieve. And before explaining you how we achieve this by presenting you the contributions, I would like to talk about the context. You might have heard about the permissionless blockchain context, where essentially a set of participants represented as black dots here will propose blocks to the blockchain. And they don't need a permission for their block to be appended to the blockchain. They can all have their block appended at some point. Similarly, they can issue transactions, and their transaction can be accepted or included in one block of the blockchain. The problem with such a model is that all nodes are usually incentivized to propose a block for a given index, which is a waste of resources. So we don't want this model. You might be familiar with the permissioned model, where essentially only a subset of nodes have the permission to propose a block that will be included to the blockchain. But some of them who don't have the permission will never be able to have their block included. Same thing for transaction. Only the nodes that have the permission can issue transaction and have their block appended to the blockchain. So we don't want this model either, because if you statically define the permission, then it looks like a centralized system. We would prefer an open model, and this is the model we adopt, where essentially you have a set of nodes that they don't need permission to send transactions that will be eventually included in the blockchain if they are correctly signed and they are non-conflicting. But we will restrict the decision of which block should be appended to a subset of nodes that have a temporary permission to do so. This permission can be revoked and given to other nodes at some point. So any node in the system could potentially decide upon one block. So it's very similar to the community blockchain as opposed to the public blockchain and the consortium slash private blockchain, where the set of nodes changes over time to decide upon one block. The first contribution is to remove the leader to achieve fairness. If you look at Byzantine for Tolerant Consensus Protocol, most of them that have been designed for the last three decades feature a leader-based model, which means that there is a particular replica that plays the special role of imposing its value to the rest of the replicas. The replicas will have to forward the request to the leader because only the leader can have its proposal decided. If the leader doesn't succeed, another leader will be elected, and so on. What we propose is a democratic version of that, and we will rely on the Democratic Byzantine for Tolerant Consensus, DBFT, that was proposed recently, where each replica can propose directly its value to the consensus. There is no need to forward to the leader the value of a replica. You can propose it directly. If you want more details, you can look at the paper, but I just wanted to point out that we're going to use the age of the transaction in order to decide which one will be proposed. The age will be based on the time the transaction has spent in the mempool of the replica. The eldest transaction will be proposed first to the consensus, and this will ensure fairness in the system. So what is the second contribution? The second contribution is to design a superblock optimization that will allow the Byzantine for Tolerant Consensus to scale as the size increases. First, it's important to note that the leader can be a bottleneck. While traditional Byzantine for Tolerant Consensus were very efficient in the local area network to run a network file system on four machines, it cannot be taken off the shelf and deployed on a wide area network, because the leader will be the bottleneck. More precisely, its network interface will not handle the load. As the number of replica increase, the throughput will decrease. This is what we observed in many cases on leader-based consensus protocol. There is another problem, which is related to the consensus definition itself. Usually, if you want to solve consensus, then you will have to ensure validity, which means that the block decided is one of the proposed blocks. For example, if you have four different nodes proposing four different blocks, then only one block will be accepted in every consensus instance. If you look on the right-hand side, you can see that if four nodes run the consensus, then one block will be decided. If eight nodes run the consensus, then one block will be decided, and so on and so forth as you increase the number of nodes. The number of blocks that will be decided doesn't depend on the number of participants in the consensus. That's why we're proposing a different consensus problem definition, which is called the set Byzantine consensus, where essentially we have SBC validity that states that a decided set of transactions is a valid non-conflicting subset of the union of the proposed sets. What this essentially means is that we're going to try to combine the blocks proposed by all the nodes into one superblock. And the result is that we will increase the number of blocks decided as we increase the number of nodes participating in the consensus. We add an SBC non-triviality property just to make sure that there is no trivial solution to this problem. What this means concretely is that if you have four nodes proposing four distinct blocks, then instead of deciding one of these blocks, we will decide all these blocks in one superblock that contains the four proposed blocks. The third contribution is sharding verification. The idea is that if you manage to make Byzantine consensus scale or BFT consensus scale, then it doesn't mean that your blockchain will scale as well. In fact, the blockchain requires computationally intensive cryptographic operation to verify the signature of each transaction that is submitted. In general, a classic blockchain will require that all the nodes verify all the transaction signatures. So instead, what we're trying to do here is we shard the verification. It's important to note that this blockchain is not sharded in the sense that the consensus run across all the nodes for every transaction, so it defines a total order of the transactions. But for the verification, we don't need all the nodes to verify a single transaction. So instead, we'll assign a subset of nodes to verify each individual transaction. Given that we can tolerate up to F failures in our system to be resilience optimal, we simply need to receive F plus one identical responses telling us whether a transaction is correctly signed in order to know whether it's correctly signed. There will be at least one correct responder among these responses. And so this response has to be correct. Of course, if we get F plus one different answers, then we have to request F additional responses. But you can see here that because F is roughly n over 3, we can divide the time it takes to verify transaction by 3. And this will multiply the performance of the blockchain by 3 times, and hence achieving scalability. So we evaluated this Red Belly blockchain in a single Amazon Web Services availability zone, where we had 300 machines. We fixed the fault tolerance to 6 because this was the highest number at n equals 20, but we increased the number of machines up to 300. We use big machines with 60 gig of RAM, 18 cores, 10 gigabit per second network between the machines of the same availability zone. And what we could see is that the throughput was increasing as we increased the number of nodes in the system. Even though the latency was increasing as well, you can see here that it doubled only between 20 and 300 nodes. While it actually, the number of blocks we were deciding was multiplied by more than 10. This is why the throughput was increasing as we increased the system size. The peak throughput we achieved at around 300 was about 660,000 transactions per second. We also compared the performance with in a much more realistic setting where we had 5 availability zones on different continents with 240 low-end VMs with less than 8 gig of memory. And we could see that the Red Belly blockchain was outperforming significantly an algorithm, ConSwan, that was based on PBFT with the optimization of BFT Smart. You can see that the latency explodes at a much higher throughput in Red Belly blockchain than in ConSwan. We also compare the performance against a randomized alternative, which is called OniBadger BFT. And we observe that as OniBadger BFT uses error correction codes, the CPU load was more intense than in Red Belly blockchain. And because there was no verification sharding, it couldn't scale like Red Belly blockchain. After 100 nodes, we couldn't plot the results because it was taking too long to run the experiment. Well, we can see that the throughput of Red Belly blockchain is quite stable as we increase to 240 nodes. Finally, we did an experiment at large scale where we had 1,000 virtual machines spread all over 4 continents in all the availability zones that we had at our disposal at that time. And we observed overall that the average latency was only 3 seconds, despite a round trip time of 300 milliseconds between Sydney and Sao Paulo, for example. So to conclude, Red Belly blockchain is a new blockchain tailored for security, because its BFT consensus is solved deterministically. This consensus was also verified with model checking for any size of parameters using parameterized model checking. This is a new result that is available online. It's fair in the sense that it doesn't have any leader and it's resistant to censorship. And finally, it's scalable in the sense that it uses a superblock and verification sharding in order to scale as the number of nodes increases. And finally, I just want to let you know that part of this, the content of this talk is included in a MOOC that is freely available online and that explains how you can make your own blockchain scale. Thank you for your attention.